when I started writing, I look at new relationships, new forms, and new models for news. So I started with forms. That's what we do, right? We think that we are encased in this form, and we know the form, and let's just adapt that. And I quickly realized, well, not so quickly, that that was all wrong. That in fact, what the internet changes is our relationship with the public we serve. And so then it forced me to ask what the proper relationship is for journalists with the public. And we tend to think it's manufacturing a product called content that we think you should honor and buy, and that encases all of our value. And that's a legacy of mass media, of treating everybody the same because we had to make a product that was going to serve everyone and everyone the same. The internet obviously changes that. So we now see the opportunity to serve people as individuals. And so that's what made me think that journalism, properly conceived, is a service. And a service, properly defined, accomplishes things for people. And if you are going to accomplish something for you, then I have to know what your needs are before I can pretend that I can meet them. And that means I have to know you as an individual or a member of a community, no longer a mass. Quoting Raymond Williams, the sociologist, there are no masses, only ways of seeing people as masses. If I see you as an individual, if I want to serve you as an individual, I now have to know you as an individual before I can get to know your needs. And that, once I got there, that changed, that tore it all apart.
Since in many ways this book is providing advice, so to speak, to the industry, to newspapers, it's helping them to think through what it is that they should be doing in these internet-y times. Would you have them look first at what it is that what services newspapers have provided traditionally that we want them to continue producing, or would you have them look at the services that they are capable right now of
Definitely the latter, because if you look at the former, what is worth preserving from journalism, then the reflex is always to preserve my newsroom. I had editors saying to me all through the last 20 years, damn it, Jarvis, when I used to work in technology and newspapers, they blamed me if the printer went down, you know, so now they blame me for the internet, right? Your damn internet has ruined everything. How are you going to support my newsroom? And the answer they didn't want to hear is the answer I gave them, which is, I'm not. I don't know. It's not going to work. I remember a meeting up at Harvard many years ago with Jimmy Wales and the soon-to-be and now former editor of the New York Times, Jill Abramson.
I believe.
Right. So you remember the moment where she said, you don't understand, the Beirut Bureau costs $3 million. Who's going to pay for the Beirut Bureau? And Jimmy Wales, being Jimmy Wales, said, not our problem. Who would have imagined that a bunch of volunteers would replace Encyclopedia Britannica worth untold hundreds of millions of dollars? It's not our problem necessarily to worry about. And of course, that was an offensive answer to the journalists in the room, but it was a realistic answer to the rest of us. There is no ordained by God right to have the structure and the staff and the operations and the resources you used to have.
But there was, would you recommend that a newspaper first look at the services that we have traditionally wanted from them and or look at the services that are part of their capabilities, things they can do? Or is that just the wrong way of dividing it?
I think we need to deconstruct more than that. Okay. But it forced us to deconstruct at a journalism school as well. When I gave this relationship spiel, my dean finally called Sarah Bartlett, called my bluff and said, okay, what if you're right that journalism becomes about relationships? Are we teaching those skills in depth at a journalism school? And I thought about it, and I said, no. And she said, how about a new degree? And so we're starting a degree in what we call social journalism. The first skill of this degree is to listen to communities, is to understand the community. What binds the community? What needs and interests bind this community? How do they define themselves? And then how do they define their needs? Only when you know that can you start to believe that you can help them meet their needs. And then you say, what am I going to bring to meet those needs? That may be a wide range of different things. Will articles and stories and news and information meet those needs? In some cases, they will. But in some cases, it will be tools. It'll be bringing people together to meet each other. It'll be organizing them like a community, Pache Barack Obama. It'll be educating them. It'll be convening them. There's all kinds of things that we can do or have done that indeed we can bring to bear again, but probably not in the form that we had.
So first of all, the creation of a new degree in social journalism, I think, is a big deal. It's really exciting. So you go out and you look at what the needs of the community are, but there's some Sorry, this will be a dumb question. There are needs that include, you know, having the streets cleaned, and clearly you're not suggesting that that's what journalists should be doing in the future. What circumscribes the ring of needs that a new journalism ought to be looking at?
You always trick me, David. You call it, it's going to be a dumb question, and then you're like a poker player. You're picking the best question I can imagine. It's a great question, and I don't know the answer. Saying it's a great question is a way to buy time.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
And I don't think I have one yet. Are you going to clean the streets? No, but are you going to help the community figure out how the damn town's going to clean the streets that aren't being cleaned? Yes. Does that mean that you just tell them, hey, your streets are dirty? No. It might mean that you bring people together and educate them about how to bring political pressure upon the town to get the streets clean. It also means that you're going to redefine communities themselves, real and virtual and temporary and permanent and so on and so forth. I saw a professor yesterday from Rutgers who has a media mobilizing project in Philadelphia. And it was a great tale, he told me. It's fresh in my brain, but it's very much a social journalism tale. They cared about the working poor. Okay, fine. Then they said, well, let's go find a community of the working poor. And they chose taxi drivers in Philadelphia. Taxi drivers work 80 hours and they make 25 grand and they're treated like employees when in fact they're independent contractors and they can't really organize and they're not together because they're all off in their own cars. What do we do for them? Well, their first media reflex was, let's go make a documentary. All right, let's make some video. That quickly turned out to not be the right move. They ended up making the thing that is just brilliantly correct. A radio station for cab drivers. It's the first good use I have heard of low-power FM, where now the cab drivers, all in their separate cars docking the city of Philadelphia, covering a third or half the city, this station, lets them educate each other, talk with each other, organize each other, share information. And there's other tools they bring to bear as well, a print product and meetings and so on and so forth. But it allowed the cab drivers to come together. That strikes me as a great example of what the future of journalism can do. And it doesn't mean that there's a set of journalists who create content that solve all problems. It instead means that often what they did in this case was they had to train them in media literacy. Media literacy means not to consume media, but to make media. It trained them in community organizing, trained them in all kinds of things, and then empower and enable them to go do what they needed to do on their own. That scales better than journalism ever scaled in the past. It's heresy, everything I'm saying, but that's how we have to rethink journalism.
So I think this is maybe one of the most radical things about your book, is that the services that the book suggests, and there's a lot of different sorts of services that you throw out there. Because the book seems to be in, let's try to think about, it's sort of in brainstorming mode,
exactly,
right?
Exactly. Because I'm not predicting the future, I'm just begging people to brainstorm themselves and come up with better ideas than I could come up with.
So if you were to ask I'm not sure this is true, but if you were to ask a journalist, a sort of traditional journalist, what is the service you provide, she or he well might say it's to provide news.
What's happening.
Yeah, so people are informed so that they, and why is that good? Because of the civic responsibility, et cetera. And you seem to, in your book, to jump, this is unfair because you talk about it pretty extensively, but to jump over the providing information is the service to providing, enabling people to engage civically in responsible and helpful ways.
I even go farther than that, which I'd say it's enabling them to solve their own problems, to improve their lots and lives.
Yeah, but within the civic domain, so.
Oh, but also individually. Also as an individual, I mean, newspapers have always done that, right? We'll help you lose weight or get thinner thighs or whatever it is. That's, you know.
So how would you respond to a journalist who said, yes, but the only way, as if I'm ignoring what you just said, Jeff, the only way to get to a public that is able to engage at the civic level, not just at the individual, but at the civic level well, is to make sure that they share a base of news and information, and that is what we need to do. And that can only, then part two is, that can only be done through something like the current infrastructure that we've built, that we call journalism.
You have appropriately channeled old mass media thinking. Good job.
Thank you.
Right? So it's that there is something that we must share as a society, right? It's the Walter Cronkite view. You and I have talked earlier about the Tom Pettit and the University of Southern Denmark and the idea of the Gutenberg parenthesis. We think that the last 600 years of the natural state, and Pettit argues that we're actually returning to an earlier state where communities share with each other in fluid, circular ways, not necessarily in linear ways like the press. So I think we got to rethink that very essence. And it's not necessarily about telling you what happened today. It's about helping you get the information you need. The example I use in the book that's the easiest for me is when Hurricane Sandy hit New Jersey, and we were very lucky in my area because we're high up, but we lost lots of trees and lots of power. What did news give me? It told me there was a hurricane, a lot of trees around, down, a lot of power.
Oh, come on, Jeff. They also had people standing out in the street with the hurricane blowing them back and forth.
Yes, yes. Very useful service. My information needs are quite obvious and apparent, right? What streets are open and closed? Where's the nearest Starbucks that has power and Wi-Fi? What restaurants are open? Are there any hotel rooms? Where are the damn power crews? When am I getting my power back? Right? My information needs to improve my lot are very clear. Well, how do you solve that? You don't solve that with articles, because all articles do is summarize and tell me what I already knew. I think you do it by bringing tools to the community, by letting the community themselves show photos of their streets and which streets are open and closed on maps. And here's where the power crew is. Know your line, power company in town. So when you think about the end result, you bring tools to bear. Part of the problem we have is the economics of what we do. We're still in mass media economics, which are volume-based economics. Reach and frequency is what we called it in old media. How many people do you reach? How often do you reach them? Online, that became unique users and page views. Same exact concept. That's a corrupting concept that leads to cats and clickbait. Right? We'll just get more and more and more people. We'll fool you into coming to us. And there's a lot of talk in my world about new media impact metrics. But that's even the wrong way to say it, because that's about enough about you. Did you like my story? How much did my story help you improve your life? How often did you read it? How often did you like it? Did you share it? Those are all the metrics we're using now. The metrics we should be using are, what's your problem? Did we help you solve your problem? It's got to start and end with the community. And in the middle, we have a bunch of utilitarian opportunities as journalists to help people do what they want to do, either directly with information that we give them or with helping them with tools so they can share their own information at a greater scale than we could do, or giving them data that they can interrogate and figure out what's what, or educating them. These are all new journalistic opportunities.
So suppose it's not Sandy, but it's the Greek economic crisis. That is something that does affect you potentially, but you don't know it because it's not knocking power out. How does journalism provide the service of letting you know about that?
Again, you're asking a deeper question than you're letting on. Because I think what...
I didn't think so, but...
I do. Go ahead. I'll find the depth in it.
Thank you.
I'll spelunk that question. Because I think that, in part, what you're asking, what you're challenging me to do is whether or not journalism has to be self-interested.
Yes.
Because what you're saying is, it's obvious that I need to know where the power is, but it's not obvious that I need to know about the Greek financial crisis. And so how do you make me care about that? Should I care? Does it matter? Is that a good for society that I care? Let's stipulate, Your Honor, that it is. Okay, that it's good to know about the world. So then the next question is, how do you make me care? Is there pure curiosity or pure altruism? I care, the poor Greeks are going through hell and here's how they got there? Maybe. But it does have an impact on me and my life. And so I think probably there is a selfish angle to news that we have to show people how it affects them and why they should care. The problem with defining community engagement and news literacy before was, we defined news literacy as reading the news we gave you.
Yes.
If you read it, you were literate. If you didn't, you were illiterate. Because we decided what was important. We do have to shift and say that we have to let people decide what's important on their own. I could argue that we, for example, overcover government and politics badly in this country. Right? That it doesn't actually, politics itself affects our lives greatly and gravely. In some ways, yes, but in a lot of the ways we covered, it doesn't really affect our lives. We're kind of making it up. We're doing the horse race stuff and all that. So you're not necessarily illiterate if you ignore our bad coverage or if you ignore CNN telling you for day after day after day they don't know where the jet is, and so on. So what you're really asking is to redefine the idea of civic engagement and news literacy and how much it springs from self-interest and enlightened self-interest. And I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah, me neither. I think that we will agree that we have overestimated the degree to which the old media succeeded in getting us to read the article about the Greek economic crisis.
And we know that now because we know what people actually read online. The and this goes back to the business model. The myth of mass media was that all readers see all ads, so we charge all advertisers for all readers. It was a brilliant thing while it lasted, because it was the lie that every reader saw every ad on the page, and we charged. Now, the advertisers knew it was a lie. We knew it was a lie. We were complicit with each other, but it was damn lucrative. And besides, we own the press, and you didn't, so we get to set the prices. Nya, nya, nya. Now, online, of course, you have the fact that a lot of news sites I know, fewer than 10% of the readers in a given day come to the homepage. Those who read the site at all come directly to stories, because they got linked to it, to something of interest. So this whole editorial ego and hubris that we are going to tell you what's important in the world, our news judgment matters, and that's a value we bring you, it's pretty much shot to hell.
Yeah, and it's one of the things that presumably good writing does. Get you interested in things that you didn't know you were interested in.
Editorial ego speaking there, to an extent.
Well, that's a tool. But there's also, I think, a strong argument to be made that the inverted pyramid, the standard form of journalistic articles, and you write really nicely about the limited role that articles, the overestimation of the importance and the constrictions that the article form puts on us, that old form actually diminishes interest. It does the job of giving you the summary at the top, but it doesn't tell you generally why you should care about the thing. Whereas even magazine articles feel an obligation to, they don't assume that you're interested, they try to generate interest.
But the problem with that string where you're going is that it does play to editorial ego. It says that you should read what we write for you, and I'm going to string you along by using entertainment tricks to do that.
That wasn't exactly what I had in mind, but
in some cases, that's true, and that's right, and that's good, and I'll be thankful for it, right? So I read a James Stewart book about data speeds and day trading, and I didn't expect that I cared about it or it mattered to me, but he made it fascinating, and I read the whole thing, right? So it's a very important skill when used properly. But we in journalism think, I've sat in meetings to hire new faculty, and every candidate will come in and will raise up the flagpole. Well, of course, we're storytellers, first and foremost, and we all salute that flag. And of course, I, being an asshole, thought, are we? And I think the problem, in part, is that we conflated entertainment and news. Now, that's an obvious statement, and that's what goes to the 7 o'clock evening news. But I mean it in a different way. I mean that because we've had to put news into a construct called a story, we thought that everything had to be a narrative, and that it was our job to entertain and to come up with that structure and flow. Well, a lot of things don't deserve that narrative, right? The jury is still out, full stop. Does not require that you have someone standing on TV at a courthouse where no one's there today, trying to, you know, give you a dramatic tale. It's just a simple little piece of information that says, if you care, the jury's still out. We've also conflated
this just then. General Franco, still dead.
A lot of your audience, I have no idea what we're talking about, but it makes us laugh. So give it to us, old guys.
Google it, kids.
So I think the story form puts us in the mind that we're entertainers. And it puts us in the mind that that's the business model. Entertainment, a unique property, a book, a novel, a movie, a TV show. I pay for watching Homeland. I happily pay for watching Homeland. I don't want to have the 87th bad rewrite of Homeland. I want Homeland. News is different, right? News allows you to just impart information. But the problem with information is that it's easily commodified. You cannot, in a society, own information. Copyright does not allow you to own information. It allows you to own the treatment of information. And we think that our treatments are wonderful. But the truth is that underlying value is just information. And once information is known, it can be spread very easily, especially on the internet, and so you can't control it anymore. So the problem with us thinking that we're storytellers is we think that we can make Homelands, we can make a sewer board meeting into an episode of Homeland, and that you should pay for it because my treatment of it was so wonderful. That's hubris.
you can, so there are certainly examples where news gets turned into entertainment and it's pandering and it's even not even very well done because it's really hard to write good fiction, you know, write a good narrative. But there's also, so there are also so many cases. For example, the news, let's say, the information escapes its bounds and gets taken up by somebody on the internet, and that's what we end up reading because that person, for example, is contextualizing it so well. Or I like Daily Kos a lot. I'm a Democrat, to a large degree because they are completely straightforward, that this is contextualized from a Democratic point of view. They happen to be pretty realistic about it. They'll give you the negatives as well. But I would personally, so I'm probably go to hell for this, but I would rather read about some news event that is basically really partisan. I'd rather get it from a partisan source that I trust and that I recognize as partisan than from a fair and balanced side. So that's not entertainment, but it is potentially getting me interested in a topic that I otherwise wouldn't have been interested in because somehow this person is writing from...
Absolutely. I'm not... That's a skill that we teach here. It's a skill that I'm not trying to kill. All I'm trying to say is...
Crashed. Sorry.
Clay Shirky of NYU says that, and I'll quote him wrong, but nothing will work and everything can work. And we don't know what that is yet, so it's going to be messy, the point is. It's going to be very messy. Time for a Gutenberg drinking game here. Whenever I say Gutenberg, you have to take a swig. It took 50 years for the book to take on the form that we now know after the invention of the press. It took 100 years, says Elizabeth Eisenstein, before the impact of the book on society was realized. Here's my favorite number. It took 150 years, till 1605, before anyone thought to invent a newspaper. This thing that we now see is so self-evident. 150 years, a century and a half. So what that means to me is that we don't know what news is yet. We don't know what the internet is yet. And whatever news becomes will be as strange to us as the newspaper was to the town crier. And they'll also resent the hell out of it.
We haven't even talked about beat reporters, but which is an important part. But that's fine. Okay. People should read the book. So
thank you.
Thanks very much.